we'll read several verses. Paul, writing to Timothy here, says, "Thou, therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus." That'd be good for us to learn that today. Be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. "And the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men, who shall be able to teach others also. Thou, therefore, endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier. And if a man also strive for masteries, yet is he not crowned, except he strive lawfully. The husbandman that laboreth must be first partaker of his fruits. Consider what I say, and the Lord give thee understanding in all things. Remember that Jesus Christ of the seed of David was raised from the dead according to my gospel, wherein I suffer trouble as an evildoer, even unto bonds. But the word of God is not bound." I say amen to that. "Therefore I endure all things for the elect's sake, that they may also obtain salvation which is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. It is a faithful saying, for if we be dead with him, we shall also live with him. If we suffer, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, he also will deny us. If we believe not, yet he abideth faithful. He cannot deny himself." Verse 14, "Of these things put them in remembrance, charging them before the Lord, that they strive not about words to no profit, but to the subverting of the hearers." We'll read a little more. "Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth." Now, that is something that needs to happen in our churches today. There's a lot of preaching, and they're preaching truth, but they're not rightly dividing the truth. And that is true preaching. True Bible preaching is rightly dividing the word of God. A lot of people are led into error because the man of God is not rightly dividing it. You say, what does it mean to rightly divide it? It means to interpret it correctly. Yeah. That's what rightly dividing the word means. It's not trying to get to say something you want it to say. It's rightly dividing it is interpreting it correctly. Look here again. It says in verse 16, "But shun profane and vain babblings, for they will increase unto more ungodliness, and their word will eat as doeth a canker, of whom is Hymenaeus and Philetus, who concerning the truth have erred, saying that the resurrection is past already, and overthrow the faith." So nevertheless, I like this part, "the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal, the Lord knoweth them that are his, and let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. But in the great house there are not only vessels of gold and of silver, but also of wood, of earth, and some to honor and some to dishonor. If a man, therefore, purge himself from these, he shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified and meet for the master's use, and prepared unto every good work. Flee also youthful lust, but follow righteousness, faith, charity, peace, with them that call on the Lord out of a pure heart. But foolish and unlearned questions avoid, knowing that they do gender strife. And the servant of the Lord must not strive, but be gentle unto all men, apt to teach, patient, in meekness, instructing those that oppose themselves, if God peradventure will give them repentance to the acknowledging of the truth." And here's a very sad picture, but a true statement. "And that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil, who are taken captive by him at his will." Now you can go home tonight and tell everybody you read a whole chapter in the Bible today.
Amen.
Verse number 14 is where I'll give you my thought tonight. Of these things, what things? Those things that we've already read, and some things that he's fixing to tell us. Of these things, put them in remembrance, charging them before the Lord that they strive not about words to no profit, but to the subverting of the hearers. He said, charging them. Paul was encouraging Timothy to charge the church that he pastored. Now, many of you may or may not know and may not be aware that Timothy was the pastor of the church at Ephesus. Ephesus was a shining light. Ephesus was a church. As you read the book of Ephesians, how that they were doctrinally sound, and how that the Apostle Paul wrote a book to them, and how that they had learned the doctrine of grace. And I heard that Dad, as he preached all day last Sunday on Ephesians chapter number 6 about the armor of God and wrestling with spiritual demons and things of that nature and spiritual battles and things. And Paul had wrote a letter to the church at Ephesus. That church was a church that seemed to have it all down pat. But yet when you read the book of Revelation, you see that they was a church also that had left their first love. They had fell out of love with the Lord. They used to be a shining light on a hill, but yet they had lost their love and their vigor and their zeal for God and their desire to be faithful to the Lord Jesus. Might I say, just because the church is doing well today does not mean a church ought to let up, get slack, or back up. That's a time that we better hold true to the things that remain, lest we become a statistic like other churches in days gone by. And Timothy was the pastor of such a great church, yet he was living in difficult days. They had a form of godliness, but they denied the power thereof. He was living in a day where there were some who was heaping to themselves teachers, having itching ears. And some of them had turned their ears away from the truth, and some of them was turning into fables. And Paul was trying to encourage young Timothy in the things of God as a pastor. Can I say every preacher needs a preacher? Can I say every pastor needs a pastor? And thank God for Paul being there to encourage Timothy and share him with his knowledge and wisdom on charging of the church and the people of God. And that's exactly what I want to preach to you tonight, and that is a charge to the church. There's several things that's mentioned here in this chapter that I think Paul was wanting Timothy to give some time and some idea and ponder and meditate and even share with the church at Ephesus. The first charge that I think that Paul was giving Timothy to give to the church that I want to give to you and I tonight that God shared with me in my study was don't flee the battle. If you'll notice in verse number 3, notice what Paul was trying to encourage Timothy. He said, thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. Let me tell you what Timothy was dealing with in that day. Of battles just like you and I. Why did he call him a soldier? Because that's what you and I are tonight. Yeah. When you got saved, you joined up with the army of God. And yeah, we've got an enemy. And the enemy is not our other brothers and sisters in the Lord. Our enemy is the devil himself and all the demons of hell. We're in a battle. We're fighting daily. Some of us, we fight mentally. We fight spiritually. We're wrestling day and night. It seems like we're in the foxhole most of the time. Some of us need to call for reinforcements. Some of us need a buddy to get in the foxhole with us. And we're in a battle. And if there's one thing that the church needs charging in today, it's don't flee the battle. Stay in the battle. Fight the good fight of faith. I got to be honest, it'd be very easy to do in this day we live in. It'd be very easy, Brother Shane, at times to quit, throw in the towel, and never come back to a church again. It'd be very easy to never go to another revival meeting. It'd be very easy to never sing another choir song. Sometimes you just get frustrated and the devil gets so hard on you. But then I look around and I see some of these older gray-haired saints. I look at Lynn and Diane Kearns, been here for years. I look at Lorenzi Mason and Doris Mason still hanging in here. I look at Bobby and Vicki Hoover back there. Come hell or high water, they right here. I look at Johnny and Linda Hill, been around here for years. I look at some of you older, Miss Nancy Robin sitting over there. I remember when Lauren would be sitting beside you every service. You was faithful and you had an impact on me. And yet I look around at those that haven't fled the battle. Sure, there's been some to get out. Sure, there's been some to leave the battlefield. Sure, there's been some that's went AWOL. Sure, there's been some to retire their weapons. But everybody ain't. There's still some on the front lines. There's still some though you're tired and you're wore out and you seem to be weak and you might even feel like how you're losing the battle every now and then. You're still in the fight for the glory of God. If there's one area that you children and you younger generation stay in the fight, hang in here with Jesus. Don't go to the world. Let's fight this fight of faith. Amen. I believe honestly that Paul was wanting Timothy to try to encourage them to not flee the battle. What if I told you that the battle for the church is going to get even harder? They're already. You just wait. You say, well, if Trump gets in as president, things are going to change. Huh. You really think so? They still don't like freedom of speech. They still don't want people preaching the truth. And everybody's saying, yeah, but he's forgets all this talk and all this being politically correct. Hogwash. I don't trust none of them up there. I'm telling you, evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse. And it's going to get tougher on the church and it's going to get tougher on the people of God. You better, it's like Brent, you listen to that song we hear around yesterday. Brother Johnny Hoover singing, he had it on a CD. We was listening to Johnny Hoover singing over 10 years ago. That song about he got his foot on the rock and his mind is made up. Hey, you better get your foot on the right and you better get your mind made up. I suited up in the Lord's army over 20 years ago now. I've took a few wounds and a couple shots for the team. I've been wounded a couple times. Even felt like running and getting out of this thing. But I'm still on the battlefield by the grace of God. I started out on the battlefield and I want to finish on the battlefield. And church, listen up. We ain't went through nothing what Jesus went through. He suffered and he bled and he died. Let's hang in there for the cause of Christ and the glory of God. Don't flee the battle. Endure hardness. That means it's going to come and it's going to happen. Endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. Number two. Don't flee the battle. But here's the second charge to the church that I think Paul wanted Timothy to share. And that is, found in verse number 8. And that is, don't forget the burial. He said, remember that Jesus Christ of the seed of David was raised from the dead according to my gospel. Why did he have to tell him to remember it if there wasn't a possibility that he could forget it, Brother Lester? You say, how in the world can people forget such a great event? I mean, this man Jesus lived 33 and a half years, a perfect and sinless life. He healed the sick, he raised the dead, called the blind to see.
Yes.
He fed the multitude, turned water into wine, and done so many other miracles that if it had been written in books, the world couldn't contain the books that should be written just about the things he'd done in 3.5 years. What about that now, friend? And so a lot of times people, they say, well, how in the world can anybody forget that? Everything that he went through, the Roman crucifixion, how that he stumped every person theologically that come to him with a question and tried to get him messed up with his thought life. He messed up the smartest of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. They couldn't question him and they couldn't corner him. They didn't know how to handle him, yet they still hated him. He loved mankind and he loved them, yet they hated him without a cause. He was the king, yet he didn't have an earthly palace. He was the God of all comfort, yet he didn't have nowhere to lay his head. He was the bread of life, yet he hungered. He was the water of life, yet he became thirsty in himself. They put him on a cross. share it anymore.
Right.
They'll share everything else as long as everybody feels good. Mm-hmm. But the gospel is the power of God and the salvation to every man that believeth.
You're right,
Pastor. To the Jew first and also to the Greek.
Yes.
Paul said we preach Christ crucified, to the Jews a stumbling block, but to those that believe is a stepping stone to higher ground.
Amen.
The preaching of the cross is to them that perish is foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of
yes,
God.
Yes, yes.
I'm telling you, the gospel is why you're saved tonight. Amen. The gospel is why I'm saved tonight.
Yeah.
And if people's going to ever come to the knowledge of the Lord Jesus, it'll be through the power and the preaching of the gospel that He died for sinners. He shed His blood for sinners. He rose again the third day for sinners. He justified us to a sovereign God. I say hallelujah. And God help us as a New Testament church. This charge is a charge to every one of us. If you're a Sunday school teacher, don't forget the gospel. That's what it's all about. We need to be charged in that direction.
Amen.
It's the gospel. Number three, I think there's a third thing that Paul wanted Timothy to charge the church. Number one, don't flee the battle. Number two, don't forget the burial. But number three, don't forsake the Bible. Look at verse 15. The Bible says, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. If there's one area that I think, another area that we need to be charged in, it's in this Bible right here we got in our hands. And we need to study to show. I know Paul was writing that to Timothy. I understand. Personally, he was writing that to him.
Yes.
But he was also supposed to commit that to faithful men who were also able to teach others also.
That's true.
Read verse number 2 of the same chapter that I just told you. And boy, we don't need to forsake this Bible. This Bible is why we're here. This Bible is why our forefathers come to this country. This Bible is the only book that tells us where we come from, how we got here, where we're at, and where we're going. And it's the only book that tells us that. Man says, I don't believe it. Don't matter. It don't make it so. It's just as real as though it was breathed yesterday.
Amen.
This is God's inspired, infallible, inerrant word of the living God. It is for English-speaking people of our day, and it is called a King James Bible. If you ain't got one, see me, I'll give you one. If you got anything else, you ain't got a Bible, you got a book.
Right.
And you better get you a Bible. You need to learn it. God ain't got many different words. There's only one word of God, and it's found right here between the book of Genesis and Revelation. Every bit of it is inspired by God Himself, and we all need to study to show ourselves approved unto God. Friend, the church needs to be charged and not forsake the word of God. This is what we need in our families.
Yeah.
And believe the lie. I can see today as many get, some have said their preacher gets in the pulpit and he'll read an article out of the newspaper. He may get in. I know preachers preach on different things. I have. Some people think it's good. I call it gimmick preaching. I've heard people preach on preachers, preach on everything. From tennis shoes to brooms to carpet to plates. I've heard them preach on everything. People say, oh, wasn't that such a good message? It might have been a good message, but it wasn't a Bible message.
Amen.
I think it's time to get away from some of this old gimmick preaching. At least a lot of times there's so much gimmick preaching is because we get too sorry to study the Word of God for ourselves to get something to preach to the people. And friend, listen, I'm telling you, this right here has got the answer to every question that man has got. It'll solve any problem that you have. It is the book that we live by, we die by. It'll be a lamp to our feet, a light unto our path. And if we'll hide its words in our heart, we might not sin against God. The problem is we like to hear it more than we do apply it.
Yes, sir.
I had a man come up to me one time and says, I like hard preaching. I said, do you really? I said, that's kind of funny. I said, a lot of people like hard preaching, but they don't like to live hard preaching.
Hey, tell it, brother.
A lot of people, they come to church to be entertained. They don't really come to hear the truth of the Scripture.
Yeah.
They want to see how loud the preacher's going to get, how wild he's going to get. He's going to throw his leg up on a pulpit, split his britches while he's preaching, or turn a communion table over. And I've done all of the above. But definitely not on purpose. Some people, that's the only reason they come. They're looking for a little character to get in the pulpit and entice them, make them feel good for a little while, and they laugh and giggle and they go home. And the whole time, they ain't even heard the word of God. And yet their ears was tickled, they felt good when they lived. There's never no repentance, there's never no correction, there's never no reproving, rebuking, or exhorting. And that was all there was to it, a little bitty show when they come, a little pep rally. That's all they wanted. And I'm telling you, our churches across America, we better get back to the blessed old book. That's what got us to where we are today. It's the Word of God that'll stand forever. When the world's on fire, the Word of God has still been standing. Let me give you another one. Another charge. Don't flee the battle. Don't forget the burial. Don't forsake the Bible. Here's a good one. Verse 16. Don't feed the babblings. Look at verse number 16. But shun profane and vain babblings, for they will increase in the more ungodliness. I know I got off on that a little bit this morning. I didn't really have intention of getting off on it tonight, but God did, because I didn't even want to write that one down, and He made me. So if you don't like it, you know, it's God's fault, not mine. I'm just a delivery boy. You don't get mad at the mailman for putting bells in your mailbox, do you? You're the one who got the bill problem. He just delivered the mail. Quit using the credit cards if you don't want the bills. Amen.
Amen.
Then husbands and wives won't get surprises when they go there to the mailbox. But anyway, so much for that. A lot of times, feeding the babblings or the gossip, it says to shun. In other words, pay that person attention. If somebody's always going to be babbling about something, somebody always is. You know who the ones are that like gossip. You know, because they're going to come to you. And if they enjoy coming to you with their gossip, you're just as bad as they are.
Amen.
I'd hate to know I was one that was a gossiper. Yeah, this is right. Somebody that listens to a gossiper, you're nothing more than a septic tank for their garbage. How do you like that? And I don't know that I've ever read that before. I don't think I have. I will steal that and count that as an original thought right now. Y'all can write that down. If you listen to a gossiper's garbage, you're nothing more than a septic tank.
That's good, bro.
Because you know what a septic tank does? A septic tank takes in all the junk and lets it seep out a little at a time. You might not tell the whole story all at one time, but you'll let a little slip here, a little slip right. If you're one of those, you ain't nothing more than a septic tank. Say, preacher, that sounds bad. Well, it is bad. Why? What did Paul say it led to? He said, this leads to more ungodliness. So it ain't going to solve a thing. It ain't going to help nothing. It's just going to lead to more and more junk and more issues and more trouble. And by the way, that person that you think you can confide in with all your gossip, you had to tell it so bad. They've got to listen so bad. But don't you think for a minute they're not going to tell somebody. Because they are. It's just a matter of time. Oh, they'll say, now listen, I told them I wouldn't tell them about this. Well, listen, this is between me and y'all, okay? Y'all can't read the word of this. I'll get in real trouble. They'll never talk to me again no more. But here's what we're going to do. We're going to pray for them about this situation, all right? But let me tell you about the situation first so you know how to pray for them. Because if you don't really know how to pray correctly, then it's just no use wasting my time. But we really need to pray for this person. Now, let me tell y'all, don't tell a word now, okay? And once that starts in the church, I've done this before. I'm not going to do it tonight. There's too many people here and it'd take too long. I remember years ago when we was back in a little church before we built on, I started a lie in the church while I was preaching. How many of y'all was here when I done that? Is y'all here? Maybe it was in a new church. Who was in a new church?
And I think it started with Johnny Hill. I think it did. I think it was Johnny first. He's probably going to mess it up. You know how I told him. Anyway, I told him something real. And I said, now, y'all, I told him, again, y'all share it with the person in front of them, all the way till it gets all up here to the front. And by the time it changed gears from back yonder to up here, that thing was done mixed up so far. They was nowhere even remotely close to what I had said originally. And most of my people think there's something bad about somebody anyway. You know, we like to spread the bad because it makes us feel good. So I'm going to jump up and down, tell their gossip, their bad. Well, hey, what if we was all good looking in your closet? Huh? A lot of people think they're so high and mighty and they ain't got no problem. What if everybody was to unload your dirty laundry right in front of everybody? How'd that make you feel? I'll be honest with you. The less people know about me, the better off I am.
Right. Yeah.
And if you really believe it, the same is true about you too. Bible even speaks about don't even let your neighbor spend too much time at your house lest he begin to hate you.
Yeah, you're right.
You hang around me a while, I promise you, you'll find some things you don't like. And you'll be telling me about it too. But you know what? If I hang around you for a little while, I'm going to find some things about you I don't like neither. I ain't going to tell nobody. Okay, I mean, I got your understanding. But why can't we just be at peace? Why do we have to share the bad stuff? Why do we have to run our mouth? Why is it? I mean, why is it? The Bible says that life and death are in the power of the tongue. The Bible also says that the tongue is a world of iniquity.
Yeah.
And it's set on fire by hell itself. I mean, this tongue right here is nothing more than a pink tornado, and it can cause more damage in a matter of seconds that your lifetime can't ever get back right. And yet, for some reason, and isn't it amazing, God gives us two things to keep it, to keep our tongue hid and safe, and that is teeth and lips. Double sealed. Or to use them both.
That's good, brother.
And I've already learned there's a lot of things in my life that I've seen that I wouldn't have got to take back. But I can't.
Yes, sir.
And it hurts. Some things I've said about people in the past, I would to God I could take it back.
Yeah, me too, Pastor.
I've learned, Brother Wayne, in my own humanity and my own sinfulness, I ain't got the right to babble about nothing or nobody. Brother Keith! I ain't got no excuse at all for looking down on a soul. Brother Brian, I am the worst of the worst when I look at my own life. Why in the world would I want to try to tear anybody down? Why? It ain't no fun. Let me give you a fourth one. A charge to the church. Number one, don't flee the battle. Don't forget the burial. Don't forsake the Bible. Don't feed the bad ones. But here's another good one. Don't follow the backsliders. Look at verse 17, 18. And their word will eat as doeth the canker. Who? The gossipers. The loud mouths. Troublemakers. Of whom is. Now notice, Paul's calling them out to Timothy. He's giving Timothy a heads up on who to watch out for. Watch these two right here. He says, Emmaus and Philetus, them two right there, they backslid, who concerning the truth have erred, saying that the resurrection is past already, and overthrow the faith of some. So there's two that backslid, and Paul was trying to tell Timothy, he says, hey buddy, you better charge the church. And by the way, keep your eye on these two right here.
Yeah.
An honest preacher will help another preacher. If it comes to a trouble. If you want a good report from this preacher, if you ever leave, well, first of all, don't ever leave. You won't have a bad report. I'm just kidding. But just leave right. If you ever leave right. If you're a member, leave right.
Yeah.
If you're a member of another church and you're leaving, leave right and come here.
Amen.
If that's what God wants you to do, I understand fish jump tanks. I understand that. I remember when W.E. and Miss Paulette first come here, W.E. thought I was going to run him off. He said, well, if you don't want us here, we'll leave. Here's why. I was so concerned. I loved this preacher. I didn't know W.E. Hunt. Didn't know Paulette. He looked me in a junkyard dog back then. I didn't know who he was. So I called Barry Wall, and Barry Wall told me he was a good man. Everything was fine. And then it was all right. So he got a good report. Now, Brother Barry would say, hey, you better watch that W.E. Hunt. And you say, that'll never happen. I promise you this. If you've ever joined this church, and I know your pastor or your local and you're around here, and we send for your letter, if we ever get a hiccup on the letter, I call the preacher. You say, well, why do you do that? I don't want no snakes in this church.
Amen, brother.
You can get mad at me and say, well, y'all not doing it. No, you ought to thank God you got a man of God in here that's going to keep the troublemaker out.
Amen.
Or make them get right at the church they're leaving first. Then they're welcome to come and be a part of what God's doing here. Can I get a amen?
Amen.
But you do it right. Don't follow backsliders.
Amen.
I've said this ever so often, Brother Mark. I've been here now 17 years. We'll be like Sunday, November. Hard to believe. In 3 years, you watch what I'm saying? In 3 years, there'll probably be some of y'all that ain't even in church anymore. I've seen it happen. And by the way, some of you already hung in here longer than I thought you would.
Praise God.
And I'm thankful for that.
Yes,
but I'm just telling you, statistically, most of the time people ain't going to hang in there. Some go back and get their feelings hurt, they get their bottle back, and they go play somewhere else. Or they get real close to somebody in the church and lovey-dovey, and that person messes up, get out of church, and out the door they go. That just tells you Jesus had nothing to do with them being here to begin with in the first place.
Amen.
Don't follow backsliders. Now listen, I love everybody and I love people, but if there's somebody backsliding away from the house of God, you better steer clear of that person. They'll drag you out with them.
Yeah.
You'll be out next. You say, you really mean it? Yes, I mean it. You better hang around those that are faithful to the house of God and been around a day or two that's been through a few fires. You start hanging around back. I'm not saying don't love them. I'm not saying don't pray for them. I'm not saying don't talk to them. But I'm telling you, you better not follow them. These two right here, Paul mentioned to Timothy. He said, hey, they've erred from the faith. Keep your eyes. Y'all want me to hush, ain't you?
No, sir.
This is Church Charge 101. And by the way, there'll be more to backslide over the years. They will. You hang in here with us, there's going to be more to backslide and get out. But some of those backsliders are going to come back and they're going to get restored.
Yes, sir.
Which is a great thing. So you don't want to run them down, talk about them, point fingers at them, or nothing like that. You pray for them from a distance. Because if you get tangled up with them, you're going to get jerked out. And then your life's going to be a mess. And then it'll be the church's fault, the preacher's fault, the deacon's fault, and everybody else's fault, but your fault. Because that's what usually happens when somebody gets out. It's never somebody else's fault that goes with them. It's always the preacher's fault. If I was really the blame for everything that everybody said I was, I'd be put in prison. Because most people are looking for a place to cast the blame anyway, because they don't want to tote it. Matter of fact, I had a woman one time. Y'all don't know her? None of you do. This is years ago. I bet if I even called her name, none of you'd ever remember. But she come here for about a year and a half, 2 years. I mean, she was in here like Flynn. Man, everything. And I knew, man, she ain't going to last long. And I was praying for her. I never said nothing to her like that. I was always an encouragement. I could tell, though, this ain't going to last long. Well, she got to missing a little bit. And a friend that she had gotten close to in church, she got out. Then she started missing a little more. I'd call her. You doing all right? Yeah, I'm fine. Nothing's wrong. Well, then eventually, she just eventually got completely out of church. And for about 6 months, she didn't dark the door. I called on her one time after she'd been gone about 2 weeks. I figured she'd just lay out of church. By the way, for those of y'all that ain't been around here very long, I don't babysit and I don't run people down that don't want to come to church. If you want to come to church, I want you to come to church. But I'm not going to beg you to come to the place of worship that you're supposed to be at anyhow. I've never done it and I'm not going to do it and don't even expect me to. So if you don't want to come to church, that's up to you and God. Now, if you get mad at somebody, I'm going to try to help you get it resolved if you're sick or something like that. But if you just get puffed up and want to leave, sayonara, friend. I don't love people that don't let them come to church. Well, after about 6 months, she'd come back. I'd already checked on her twice. She sat in the church. She sat right there about where Miss Joy is sitting right now. I see her, man. I went straight to her. Hey, good to see you. How you doing? She said, well, I was wondering if you was ever going to check on me. I said, well, I was wondering if you was ever going to let me know why you wasn't coming to church. When did it come? Why ain't people supposed to tell the preacher? Why is the preacher supposed to just figure out when they ain't going to be here and they ain't coming? I turned the dog on her. She bowed up like a hoppy toad and ain't been back. And I said it in a nice way. I did. I said it in a nice way, but she got mad. Bowed up mad because I didn't go down there and check on her. She was backslidden, and I know if she'd have hung around, all she would have done was grumbled and complained and got somebody else stirred up and tried to drag them out with her. She wasn't going to hang around here. It wasn't nothing about Jesus. It wasn't nothing about learning the Bible. Yeah. Yeah. It wasn't nothing about the glory of God. It wasn't nothing about sinners getting saved. It was about her petty little feelings and wanting somebody to feel sorry for her and wanting a preacher to give her a pacifier and a bottle all the time and burp her every now and again on the back. I'm not a babysitter. I love you. I'll pray for you. I'll be there for you if you need me to. But I'm a man of God. God called me to preach, and that's all I know how to do, and I don't even know how to do that. I ain't good at it. I'm a preacher.
Amen.
Yes, you are.
That's all I am. Well, some of y'all done cut me on fire. Charge of the church. Let me give you this last one. We're done. Don't flee the battle. Don't forget the burial. Don't forsake the Bible. Don't feed the battlers. Don't follow the backslider. Verse 22. Don't fail to bow.
That's right. Amen.
Don't fail to bow. Look at verse 22. Flee also youthful lusts, but follow righteousness, faith, charity, peace. Watch this. With them that call on the Lord out of a pure heart.
Amen.
See there? They're bowing. Why was they calling the Lord out of a pure heart? Watch verse 21. Here's why they need to do it. If a man therefore purge himself from these, what things? Bad things. He shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified meat for the master's use, and prepared unto every good work. Verse 23. But foolish and unlearned questions avoid, knowing that they do gender strife. He says, listen, y'all better pray together. What he's saying is, hook up with somebody that's praying. Get with them and call on the Lord out of a pure heart.
Amen.
Get with them people with a pure heart, and you better get on and you better pray. And we better not fail to. There's a revival going on up in Burlington, North Carolina. There's 102 saved Friday night. Some of y'all have been going about every night. I try to watch it if I can. We've been able to go four times or five. I try to watch it on Facebook when I can watch it. God's doing something up there. It's not just there either. There's a revival going on now up in Yakima. Brother John Dorsey has been preaching up there. They're getting ready to start their fifth week. There's been right at 200 saved up there in 2 weeks up in the mountains. There's another going on up in Burnsville. There's another meeting revival going on down around Georgia. God's doing something all across this country, especially on the East Coast. There's a move. There's a shake. There's some people getting dizzy, mad, and God, and praying. Not only do we need to pray for these right revivals, but we better pray for our country.
Amen.
This country we live in is in a mess. The two bozos we got running for the leader of the free country, it's a shame and disgrace. It really is.
Yeah.
I mean, any of it, it just blows my mind what we got running. And we better be praying for America. Listen, ain't no government going to straighten this mess out. It's going to take God. And we better get back to praying. And somebody better, the church better get back to praying. That's what we better do. Better teach these youngins to belly up in that altar and have an altar at home. Pray with their kids. Pray with their children. Pray with their wife. Pray with their husband. Pray as a family. We better pray. Jesus even said his house should be called a house of prayer.
Yes, sir.
And we've turned it into everything else but that. And prayer is the most important thing of our day. Spending time with God and fellowshipping with Him. A charge to the church. God help us to never stop praying.
Amen.
How's your prayer life tonight? I think, honestly, we're living off of credit. We don't pray like our mamas and daddies and grandmas and grandpas and generations behind us did. J.D. Shaver, remember him telling me one time, he was a little boy. He's been dead now about 10 years. His living today, I guess he'd be 100. Remember him telling me one time, he was a little boy, there hadn't been no rain in weeks. And back then, this was probably in the 20s, they had to pray. They planted gardens, they lived off of what they planted. And they had to have rain. He said, it rained in weeks. They was losing everything in the garden. The preacher called the church into prayer. He said he remembered his grandma and his mom and his dad. And I loved getting on the horse and buggy. And grandma, he rode on her lap on the horse and buggy all the way to church. And when grandma got on the buggy, she got her umbrella and had an old umbrella right there on the buggy. He said, "Man, why are you getting an umbrella? We're taking it to church." She said, "Son, we're going to pray. It's going to rain." He said, "Every time they done it, before they get back home, the bottom would fall out." You say, "Preacher, you really believe that?" You better believe it, friend. There's power in prayer. The reason so many people has lost faith in God's ability to answer prayer is because they don't pray no more. All they do is pray a little simple prayer. Ain't nobody agonizing before God. Where's our altars at out in the woods in the middle of nowhere where you call on the sovereign God of this universe? This country was founded by men and women that knew God and had a prayer life. And if we're going to see America brought back from the doom of destruction, it'll be from the people of God praying. If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will he hear from heaven, forgive our sin, and heal our land.
Amen.
Let's pray. Let's all stand this soon. I'll tell you what, Brother Daniel, will you come pray? Brother Dan, give me a silver break. Brother Dan, you come play.